The effects of diet on heart disease risk are seen across different ethnicities and across different cultures. As you have seen, Lauren Cordain wants us to have low cholesterol, much to his credit. That humans should have much lower cholesterol than is typical now is becoming a mainstream view. Hunter-gatherer populations with parasite burdens and vegetarians without parasite burdens both serve as the models here. I'll pass on the parasites in favor of option B. Lower is better because blood cholesterol has been shown to directly relate to rates of death from heart disease, even at the low end of the scale. Cholesterol confusionists routinely start their chicanery by pretending to educate us about the important roles cholesterol plays in the body. As if this would be news to the global community of medical researchers and scholars. Of course, cholesterol has critically important functions in the body. The question is it healthy to have chronically elevated concentrations of it? Is high cholesterol unhealthy? Let's look at other factors besides diet and genetic defects that can raise your cholesterol. Being overweight can raise your LDL or bad cholesterol. Old age is associated with higher cholesterol. Chronic inflammatory disease can raise your cholesterol. Acute mental stress can raise your cholesterol, and this is well established. This is one of the ways work-related stress makes you vulnerable to heart disease. The threat of unemployment is stressful too, so it can raise cholesterol as well. Steroid use will raise cholesterol in bodybuilders. This is a great example of how the appearance of health and actual health are not necessarily the same thing. Higher cholesterol is also associated with Alzheimer's disease. The same goes for sleep apnea. And of course, high blood cholesterol is also associated with metabolic syndrome, the consumption of an unhealthy diet, and cardiovascular disease. This is all guilt by association, of course, but it's enough to convince me that lower is indeed better. On the other hand, exercise and weight loss lower your cholesterol. Many plant foods lower your cholesterol as well. There have been many studies showing this, which raises a question for the confusionists. If it's healthy to have high blood cholesterol, and if plant foods like almonds and blueberries lower your cholesterol, does that make almonds and blueberries damaging to your health? Cholesterol research has a fascinating history. I recommend reading the articles in this series by Daniel Steinberg, author of The Cholesterol Wars. I'll refer to this valuable material repeatedly. In their lecture at the awarding of their Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 1985, Brown and Goldstein gave us perhaps the most often repeated quote about cholesterol. Cholesterol is the most highly decorated small molecule in biology. Among the 13 Nobel Prizes it helped scientists earn, one never went to this man. This is Nikolai Anichkov. Almost 100 years ago, as a young experimental pathologist at the Military Medical Academy in St. Petersburg, Russia, he demonstrated that atherosclerosis could be induced in rabbits simply by feeding them cholesterol. Through his research, Anichkov was the first to describe in detail the progression of heart disease and its connection to dietary cholesterol. This has made Anichkov a controversial figure for some, who question the validity of lessons learned from experiments on rabbits. This theme is recurrent among those who sow confusion over cholesterol. No animal model is ever good enough for them. Do they not understand that animals that are especially vulnerable to diet-related diseases have been valuable in research precisely because they are so vulnerable? Atherosclerosis had been described long before Anichkov's work. Rudolf Virchow described its structure, observing that it was not a deposit on the interior surface of the artery or endothelium. In 1854, he recognized that it was the product of an inflammatory process. Cholesterol confusionists usually base their arguments on the idea that inflammation, not cholesterol in the blood or diet, causes heart disease. This is an either-or fallacy. Inflammation was seen as important before diet was. The presence of inflammation is not a matter of controversy today. A yellowish, fatty substance was recognized as the major constituent in these plaques by Adolf Windhaus in 1910. This substance is cholesterol. In this context, we can see how Anichkov in 1913 guessed correctly that dietary cholesterol could produce this disease. The connection of diet to heart disease should not be such a hard sell. Carnivores do not develop atherosclerosis when they eat their natural flesh diets, but feed an herbivore a carnivore's diet and it will develop atherosclerosis. The connection of diet to atherosclerosis has been demonstrated in a long list of animal models. Surprising to me, however, was that a fatty, cholesterol-rich diet has even been shown to induce atherosclerosis in a domestic cat, which is an obligate carnivore. Although virtually the entire medical world accepts and understands the role of saturated fat and cholesterol in the etiology or causation of heart disease, it was not always this way. Opposing theories were preferred through the 1970s. The pivotal role of blood cholesterol in the development of heart disease, an idea known as the lipid hypothesis, was not widely accepted in the United States until the 1980s. The controversy over the lipid hypothesis did not abate in the UK until the 1990s. The old cholesterol deniers are mostly long dead. In retrospect, the resistance to the lipid hypothesis is culturally understandable. People love their fatty foods. Those who vilify the government's role in educating the public about the dangers of cholesterol don't seem to appreciate that government agencies have changed their policies in response to developments in science. Don't we want our institutions to react to new information? This old government educational publication gave milk, eggs, meat and cheese, and even butter their own separate food groups. When we see that it was believed that 2 tablespoons of butter per day promoted health, we can understand why some people had a long way to go to accept the dangers of such foods. Animal models were just part of the rationale for the lipid hypothesis. It has been observed directly in humans as well. In 1916, Cornelius de Langen demonstrated the effect of diet on blood cholesterol in humans. He had noticed that the mostly vegetarian natives of Indonesia did not seem to suffer from heart disease. He conducted his own diet experiment, feeding 5 natives a high-fat, high-meat diet. This produced a dramatic elevation in blood cholesterol. Since then, at least 395 studies conducted in metabolic wards with carefully controlled experimental diets have collectively made the case for the effects of saturated fat and dietary cholesterol on blood cholesterol levels. Just as importantly, the lipid hypothesis has been demonstrated in epidemiological studies. The most famous epidemiologist for the diet heart idea has been Ansel Keys, and I'll talk about him next. In the meantime, I suggest you pause the video and read this excellent short description of the role of cholesterol in promoting heart disease if you don't know much about it. It touches on the difference between LDL or bad cholesterol and HDL or good cholesterol.